They've won Tonys and Oscars and Emmys and Grammys. There's no red carpet because they're home in their jammies. From Melrose Place to Broadway to Janeway and her crew, let Seth and James bring all the stars to you.
Anywho,
they're entertaining everyone, so who's gonna grouse? Just sit right back and you'll hear some tales on Stars in the
Hi, everyone. I am so excited to be here. My name is Ruthie Fierberg, and as you can see, I am neither Seth Rudetsky nor James Wesley, but I am hoping to fill their shoes tonight. Some of you may know me from my former position as executive editor at Playbill, or from leading talks at the 92nd Street Y or Broadway Con, or from my podcast, Why We Theater. But tonight, I'm excited to play the role of understudy who gets to go on for Seth and James, and your host for our FOSSE Reunion. Okay, I am obsessed with this show. I have been since I was a little girl. And to prove it, I have some revealing photos. So when I was a kid, I grew up a dancer, and so was a musical theater kid. My bat mitzvah was obviously going to be Broadway themed. And every centerpiece was a different show. You know, instead of table one, table two, you were at the Guys and Dolls table or you were at the Cats table. And my table was the FOSSE table. But not only was my table the FOSSE table, my cake was an ode to FOSSE. That's right. That's my cake with the FOSSE playbill. But instead of FOSSE, it says Ruthie. And my mother still has that playbill in our freezer. Thank you, Mom. That's what it looks like today. Broadhurst Theater. Ruthie was there. But in all sincerity, I love this show. I grew up dancing FOSSE. The style just speaks to me. And I was awed when I saw it on stage at the Broadhurst Theater. It earned 8 Tony nominations and won 3 of those, including Best Musical, Best Lighting Design, and Best Orchestrations. And we happen to have the Tony-winning orchestrator here this evening. The show opened, like I said, at the Broadhurst on January 14th, 1999, and closed August 25th, 2001. It ran for 22 preview performances and 1,093 regular performances. It was conceived by Richard Maltby Jr., Chet Walker, and Ann Ranking, and it had to somehow capture all of FOSSE in this one show, and it managed to include numbers from Big Deal, The Little Prince, Liza with a Z, Dancin', Sweet Charity, The Kiss Me Kate Movie, Redhead, The Pajama Game, Chicago, Pippin, Damn Yankees, The Bob Hope Special, and all that jazz. And we have some phenomenal people here with us tonight to talk about it. First, I want to introduce Lainie Sakakura, who was the dance captain, performer, and reconstructed the dances for FOSSE. She grew up training with the San Francisco Ballet and became a member of Ballet Hispanico at age 18. She was a Rockette. She's been on Broadway in The King and I, The Flower Drum Song, Cheetah Rivera, A Dancer's Life. Please welcome Lainie Sakakura.
Hi, Ruthie. Thank you.
Hi, Lainie.
Thank you. I didn't know you knew so much about me.
I make it my business to know. And we are so grateful that you're here tonight. Lainie is actually choreographing and working on a show at Goodspeed in Connecticut, my home state. So thank you so much for making the time. Amazing.
Thank you for having me.
As I mentioned, we have Tony Award-winning orchestrator Doug Besterman. He has done no less than 27 Broadway shows, 6-time Tony nominee, 3-time Tony winner for FOSSE. His co-orchestrator was Ralph Burns, but you may have also heard his orchestrations in shows like Thoroughly Modern Millie and The Producers. Please welcome Doug Besterman.
Hey, everybody.
Hi, Doug.
Hey, Ruthie. So nice to meet you. Hi, Lainie.
Hi, Doug. I miss you.
Likewise.
This is also really fun for me because this is a group of people who I haven't interviewed before. And at Playbill, it was like, you know, you're in a season. You interview the same people over and over, which is really special. But thank you, James and Seth, for making my dreams come true. All right, next up, we have Marc Calamia, who grew up around theater. I found this fun fact about you, Marc, that your mother was not only an actor, but a float designer for Mardi Gras. So cool. He made his Broadway debut in Chicago and is also now an executive producer and the founder of production company Sageworks. So we got all different types of storytellers in the room. Please welcome FOSSE performer Marc Calamia.
Hey, everybody. Hi, Ruthie.
Hi.
Hi, Lainie. Hi, Doug.
Hi, hey, Marc.
So good to see y'all. Yeah, that's a crazy fun fact that you found. Actually, let me correct it, though, if I could.
Oh, please. My dad was the float painter. Oh.
And my mom was a singer, and yeah, she inspired me, took me all the way to New York, sent me there even before I graduated high school. And then, anyway, yeah.
We're going to have to get your bio corrected.
No, yeah, we just fixed it. Oh my goodness. So good to be here. Thank you for having me. I appreciate
Absolutely. And next up, we have Marianne Lamb, who made her Broadway debut in Song and Dance. And she has been in such shows as Starlight Express, Carrie, Jerome Robbins Broadway, Goodbye Girl, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, Chicago, FOSSE, Seussical, and Curtains. She has been in 8 Encores shows. She herself is also a choreographer. Welcome, Marianne Lamb.
Hi.
Hi.
And I am right now in Scott Wise and Elizabeth Parkinson's Dance Theater School.
Oh, my God. Yes.
Yes.
Yay. The FOSSE family grows strong.
Yes. Hi, everybody.
And next up, we have Rochelle Rack, iconic dancer from Cats, FOSSE, Thou Shalt Not, The Oklahoma Revival, Look of Love, Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, most recently, Catch Me If You Can. You may have also seen her on the national tour of Smokey Joe's Cafe or Flashdance. And of course, she is still choreographing and teaching and being a star. Welcome, Rochelle Rack.
Hi. Hi, friends. Oh, my God. Welcome to SAS Studios. How is everyone?
I love Stas Studios. I needed my own graffiti wall back here.
Absolutely.
Like, you're getting the tennis and my Broadway tickets, which are emblematic of me, but I think a graffitied Ruthie would be stronger.
I think so. I agree.
And last but not least, we have Parker Esse, who replaced in the cast of FOSSE, which is super cool to learn what it's like to be put into a show as intense as this. He has Broadway credits from choreographing Tale of Two Cities and Finian's Rainbow, and is now working as a choreographer. He's been awarded for his productions at Arena Stage. He did City Center Bed in a Chair, which I loved. He's also worked at Goodspeed. So please welcome Parker Esse.
Yay.
Hey, everybody. Yeah, thank you, Ruthie. So good to see all your faces. Everybody.
Me too, man.
I know. Yeah. How exciting is this?
Love it.
Incredible.
I love it. So very sadly, Sergio Trujillo, I'm very sorry, everyone. He texted me 15 minutes before we were supposed to go on. There's an emergency with one of the zillions of productions that he's working on because he's doing, you know, the big Nick Jonas Jersey Boys. He's working on Annie Live. He's working on the Tonys. So sadly, we won't be able to hear from him tonight, but he sends his love, and we're thrilled to have the group we have here. You guys are not even ready for all of the juicy goodness.
Stories.
All the stories. All right, so Lainie, I want to start with you because, like any show, before FOSSE came to Broadway at the end of 1998, that tail end for a rare January opening, there is a development process. There's workshops, there's an out-of-town, but you were not only a performer and a dance captain, you reconstructed the dance. So I know you came early on in the process. How did FOSSE come to you? How did you come to FOSSE?
I'm going to try to say this really quickly. It's a, okay, 1994, Chet Walker with Tim Albrecht came to see a Broadway show that I was in. Then Chet invited me to these invited classes because we were showing Gwen Verdon that we were capable of doing the FOSSE work, our generation. That's kind of new. Back then, we were the new generation. And so that brought me in. Chet Walker was the one who originally conceived the idea and brought it to Gwen, and then they collaborated originally, and so I was part of that group. Then I had to do double duty between a Broadway show and the first workshop and the first pre-production, and we kind of went back and forth so crazy, and I was running back and forth to 890. Remember 890, everybody? And
890 Broadway. There's going to be a documentary or a book written some way just titled 890 Broadway, because everything happened there.
Yeah. So we were doing pre-production in New York. It was going crazy. It was like insane. I was going back and forth. And so then I was learning numbers so fast. That's when Chet asked me to be dance captain. And so for the first workshop in Toronto, I was dance captain and also actually assistant to the choreographer. And then let's say there's a million pre-productions later, which was Chet, Bill Hastings, Brad Musgrove, Mike, and myself. And then we went to the second workshop. I won't bore you with all the details, but basically there was a million versions that we went through. I think Brad and I worked on ultimately about 70 FOSSE numbers total.
Wow. So
we would do pre-production, just setting choreography on just us. So we'd play every single part, and then we'd show them to, you know, Garth Drabinski would come in, Marty Bell would come in, and we'd show, like, Richard Mulpey would come in. So we'd show, like, we would just
producers and directors, for those who don't know the names.
Yeah, so we just show them all. And then, so I guess we ended up, when Anne Rankin came in, that's when Brad and I became dance reconstruction was our titles, as well as on stage co-dance captains. So, and then that was a whole process, three cities out of town, until finally a journey from 1994, we got that up finally on Broadway, 1999.
Wow. So in those early classes, you're working with Gwen Verdon, what were they looking for, and what were you learning from her? And as the partner for, to learn Bob FOSSE choreography from Gwen Verdon, the muse and the woman, like, what was she like?
Well, I can't answer what they were looking for exactly.
Yes, you're not them.
Yeah, so you'd have to ask Chet and Gwen, and you know, that's, but I will say that, what was that process like for me? Like, what it was? It was like heart palpitating. You'd wait for a phone call. You'd get every week after you danced, you would wait for a phone call to see if you were invited back the following week. And they went hundreds of dancers. Everybody you knew, everyone you saw were in those classes. It was incredible. And then the original owner of Broadway Dance Center, Richard Elner, donated the space to us. We started with once a week, then twice a week. There was like secret class, and then a third secret class. And then, you know, we're like, did you get invited to the third class, the second class, only the first class? Oh my God, what does that mean? So, yeah. But in general, I will say that being with Gwen dancing, she's in a leotard and tights, maybe we'd spend the whole 90 minutes sometimes just working on one or two pieces of vocabulary, just step by step by step. I have to say it was the most incredible experience of my life to be able to be a part of those beginnings. And I hope someday Chet's able to talk about that part for
yes,
all of us.
Yes, he is working on a new musical in the UK, so he couldn't be with here tonight, but he sends his love, and we will always take new work from Chet Walker. Absolutely. So Doug, I'm curious, at what point did you enter the process? Because there's, you know, these songs come from other shows, so there's not a composer that they were working with. So I'm wondering, were you there earlier on than usual?
I was racking my brains trying to remember exactly when I started, because it was a really long time ago. I was brought in by Gordon Harrell, who obviously is not with us tonight, although he's still with us. Gordon was really the musical genius behind the recreation of all of these numbers from FOSSE and some of from FOSSE projects. Some of the work that we did was to recreate what had been heard originally. And some of the work we did was to rethink and reconceive. Mm-hmm. And some was to invent things that weren't, that never were. So so Gordon definitely brought me in, and I was introduced to Ralph Burns, who, the legendary orchestrator Ralph Burns, who came, you know, he had done really all of Fosse's shows and had come from the jazz world. I mean, Ralph was a legend. And I was introduced to Ralph by Gordon, and Ralph said, Doug, it's gonna be 50-50, we're gonna be even across the way, you're getting paid when I'm getting paid, and that's how we're gonna do it. Wow. Okay, thanks, Ralph, you know.
Yeah, and, seriously.
I think that was probably the fall of 97. There was a workshop at 890, because I remember we went out to lunch afterwards. I think it was the fall of 97, maybe. I think so. And then we did a bunch of recording dates where we made music that was going to be used to help advertise the show. So we kind of did little 16 bar snippets of numbers, and that was done in Toronto in the winter before the 98 Toronto production. And that's where, you know, I was really working with Gordon and Ralph and in a studio with players. So that's how I was first brought in. And then we did a lot of the work long distance, as we do. They flew me back and forth to Toronto. I was living in New Jersey at the time. And then once the show was getting into tech and near when the orchestra would come in, then I went to Toronto full time. But what was really weird was I moved that summer. So the summer of 1998, I sold my house in New Jersey and moved to L.A. So my family went to L.A. without me. And I went to Toronto, so I was kind of homeless. I didn't really have a place to live.
Oh my gosh.
It was this really bizarre thing. But anyway, that was my experience that summer.
And so because you came in like around the time of Toronto, were all of the numbers basically chosen and you were building?
No.
Were there things that were like, yeah, I'm curious, like how many of the numbers were chosen because we like the sound of the music? How many numbers were like, and I don't even know if you know the answer, but if you do, I'd love to hear it.
Well, these guys would probably remember more than me, but I know I did a lot. I orchestrated a lot of numbers that did not end up in the show. They were trying things. I mean, we did, I remember doing them from Damn Yankees, Shoeless Joe, right? There was a whole shoot. We did Shoeless Joe for a while. Well, that was like 3 days of work for me at least. And I think that number sort of came and went. There was a lot of material that was kind of coming and going at the last minute. So they were still very much discovering what the show was, right? And then it was a three-act version. There was a three-act version, and then there were two-act versions, and there were different three-act versions, and it was, right?
Yes.
So it really was, there was a lot of development going on. It was different.
And I see Marianne and Rochelle nodding. Like, what was your... Well, first, let's start at your beginning. Did you audition for the show? Were you called in to just do a workshop and ended up being cast? What was your journey? Marianne, let's start with you.
Okay. I did not do one workshop. I mean, I actually did Andrew Lloyd Webber's Music of the Night tour with Garth. And I was in Chicago at a new baby. Mm-hmm. And I was just opening Chicago, and I got a call, and they were like, listen, I've heard about these workshops. And they said, why don't you come in and audition? This was just during the final auditions, and they were going to Toronto. I did not do any work before this, any of the Fosse. And I went in, and it was Chet Walker. And then the next day was the call back, and I went in, and it was Anne Ryan King.
Yep.
And I was actually doing the show with Anne Ryan King. And I was like, Annie, what are you doing here? And she's like, I'll talk to you later. I'm now the director. And I was like, okay. And that was a real mystery. And Garth was there, of course. And he was like, lamb, you know. And I also did song and dance. So,
right.
You know,
I can't believe you just told the same story that I was going to tell Marianne Lamb. I love it. Because yeah. I was doing a show on the road and had flown back to New York and didn't tell anybody to do the callbacks. And Anne, who was, it was Chicago on the road.
Yeah.
And Anne walked in the room. It was the same thing. And I was like, oh my God, I'm fired. I'm fired. I'm working for her already. And here I am in New York, moonlighting.
And now she knows. And now she knows.
And she just linked at me. She was like, it's okay. Don't worry.
And she did the same to me. She did the same to me. I was like, you didn't tell me this last night. But anyway, I just wanted to say that I was so excited to go from Chicago to FOSSE. And I just remember the Weislers thought that FOSSE would close Chicago. They were like, Marianne Lamb, you cannot, we're in a big hit right now. You cannot go and do FOSSE. I mean, they were so nervous. And what happened, it was the opposite.
Yeah.
FOSSE just exploded in Chicago. Ah, there I am.
There you are.
You just scared me. She's so intense, that woman.
No, but it's true. Here we are 25 years later.
But I do have to say that it was the very first time that I started an original company. Mm. And everybody knew the choreography but me. Because they did so many classes and so much. It was crazy. And by this time, we were, Doug, you were so right. It was over 3 hours with two intermissions, and there was all this material, and everybody, except maybe four of us, right? You guys, and I think three of us are here, did not learn anything. And so we were completely 100% cramming. I'll never forget. And I had a baby. I had a brand new baby. And
oh, wow.
So I was like learning.
But
all
I have
the
to
style.
Imagine that being in Chicago and at least having some of that style in your body helped, no?
I have to tell you honestly, Annie, I mean, it was Chicago was Anne Ryan King's version of FOSSE, which she's an amazing choreographer. I miss her so much. And I the only reason why I came to Broadway was because of Anne Ryan King. We ended up going to the same school. We're from Seattle, Washington. And I miss her so much. And I was so lucky just this last summer, I got to work with her at North Carolina School of the Arts.
Oh,
and
wow.
I have to, yeah. And the 25th anniversary of Chicago is coming up also.
It's really crazy.
So crazy. Isn't that crazy? But
back on Broadway, Chicago, September 14th.
Chicago had a lot of ad-libbing in it. It had a lot of feeling in it, but it was not the FOSSE. I mean, I want to tell you, Ruthie, you were correct. I thought I was dancing FOSSE when I was doing Chicago, 100%. I was like, I'm a FOSSE dancer. No, not until I stepped into FOSSE that I was like, oh, this is FOSSE.
Okay,
not
so we're going to get to that. We're going to get to that. I want to pause and remind everyone out there who's watching that you are looking at a group of creatives who can all, I don't want to say anyone has, I have, but can all benefit from the Actors Fund. And all of these people are now storytelling, choreographing, directing, writing. They had been performing. And the Actors Fund is such an important organization that allows artists, hundreds of thousands of artists over all these many years to keep doing what they're doing. And so we are here tonight for them. This is a fundraiser. So please donate. As you can see, donate at starsinthehouse.com. If you forward your donation receipt to donations@starsinthehouse.com, one of these lovely folks on screen will read your name aloud and you'll get a little shout out from the cast of FOSSE. And I cannot overemphasize the amazing work that the Actors Fund does. I've been writing about them for 15 years of my career. I mean, everything from housing to medical services, mental health services, helping with your taxes when you've worked on a national tour and your taxes are in like all 50 states and you're like, how do I do this? Or your next pair of dance shoes. So please continue to support and hopefully we'll get one of these people to shout out your name if you do. On that note, dancing all over the country, Rochelle Rack, how did you come to FOSSE?
I was not a FOSSE dancer at all, for sure. I had no idea what I was doing. I was in Smokey Joe's Cafe on the road. They were having an audition in LA. I went, I think I wore a red leotard immediately. I don't know. I had no idea. I didn't know the FOSSE vibe at all. But I auditioned also for Chet Walker and was cast. And I went back to Smokey Joe's Cafe, but they had cast me, I guess, as a swing. And I had done the swing. Am I freezing up again? Wait a minute. I'm not going to freeze up.
We can at least hear you. Your sound is totally there.
It's so strange. I'm always used StreamYard. So I won't move. I'll just be still like a mannequin. I did not know a step of FOSSE. I was in three numbers in 3.5 hours. So that's how much material I was in. I was a featured lady that wasn't featured. I didn't know a thing. I also, like Marianne Lamb, I was just catching up. I think I wore a leopard leotard to the first rehearsal. You can ask Elizabeth and Scott Wise because they were like, who's the girl in leopard, honey? So I sent for all of my FOSSE blacks. And and then it just started. I kept practicing every dance in the corner. And eventually I auditioned for Gwen Verdon to be in the ensemble of The Rich Man's Frug. And I was cast in the ensemble. So I was in a show being cast in an ensemble role. So the audition was constant and it was always happening, wow, even when you were there. So that was really something. And it was very challenging because I didn't know anything or anyone. And I was luckily helped by a lot of kind dancers. And they kept me. They decided to keep me.
So I want to go into what the FOSSE style is. What defines it? How does it feel in your body? What is it like to learn it? And so, Lainie, I'm going to go back to you since you were in those earliest rooms. What was your body doing? What were you demanding of it? And what to you defines FOSSE?
You know, honestly, I love hearing these stories from Lamb and Seth and Marc. And I want to hear from Parker too.
Because, yes, don't worry, you know, Parker. I didn't forget about you.
No, because honestly, you know, I feel like FOSSE was such a part of me for so long. And because I had done it from the very beginning, I will, you know, that so actually hearing their stories of what it was like for them coming into it is so fascinating to me. So I feel like maybe learning how it felt coming in is fresher in their mind. But I think for me, what happened, so with FOSSE, what I've been through so many hundreds of dancers teaching amazing dancers. Not everyone can do FOSSE. That's what a lot of people don't understand. It doesn't mean you're not good. You might be the most brilliant dancer, but you just might not be a FOSSE dancer. And for me, the work sat very well in my body and also just for me emotionally. And I think that's also the difference. If you hear Graziella Dindale tell you a story, you have to have her tell you the story, what it was like for her, you know, or Chita Rivera talk about what it was like for them working for FOSSE. You know, everyone will have a different reaction to that kind of work. And so for me, it just hit me in a way that I just loved. It combined the specificity. I loved it because I'm classically trained. So I love that. I love that being really specific. I love the style and the storytelling. And also I just grew up watching movie musicals. So I had been watching FOSSE style since I was really little. I also grew up, my first dance teacher was a vaudeville dancer. So this kind of aesthetic all hit home. So as soon as I started it, I knew that I wanted to do it more than anything. So that's why I left a Tony Award winning Broadway show after only being there 6 months, including rehearsals, to go work in the snow for 4 weeks for, I think, what we'd get paid. Doug, it was like $400 a week. It was like, it's sitting in dorms because I loved it that much. So, yeah.
But how about please, somebody else Marc? I was going to say, Marc, let's go to you. I want to know what it was, like what defines FOSSE for you and learning it in this way.
Well, you know, we were talking about my mom at the very beginning. She did Chicago. It exposed me and all that jazz. The movie came out as a kid. I just knew that I needed to be with that group of people. I didn't know FOSSE from another director, but that was the dominant voice that persuaded me into the theater long before I was able to dance the show and learn. Thank you, Lainie. And thank you, Lamb. And thank you, Rack. All of you for teaching me what you knew and putting me on the next level. What struck me, though, and what Ann did in Chicago and Fosse, I think, because I didn't get to work with him, sadly. I was determined to, and then he died. It was like, damn, you know, and then this show came about, like the clouds parted for me because it did sit on my body well. I think so, in terms of the structure, the turned in, the slanted, the hunch, all that was kind of like already working for me. but then what Ann did and what I think Bob did in his time was single out the strengths, the natural strengths in each of the performers that he brought together. It was very eclectic. I mean, if you look at what Ben Vereen did, and then what, you know, and how, what in the early days and when he was using him and how he was featuring him. And then if you look at the cast of Chicago, of Fosse, and how the variety of us that were in there, that was very much like Bob Fosse too, I think too. And finding that spark that each person has naturally. And Rack, I'm going to use this moment right now to remind you that on the night that I left the show, And Ann was like, oh, and Mark's leaving the show and the crowd. I'm like, oh my God, this is so embarrassing. Curtain call, it's not about me, you know, right at this moment. And Rack leans over and goes, do a toe touch or something, Sass. Like the audience is looking at you like she's talking about you. You need to do something. I was like, yes, thank you. And I took this moment. I'm grateful for that moment because I took that little, you know, that little thing.
I love that.
That was my spark. And I thank you, Annie, for pulling me into that. I think that's what it takes. And that's the common thread. The spark, I mean, the spark. Mm.
Rochelle, how did you find the spark?
When I was born, I think I found the spark. I found the stillness in Fosse. That was, which maybe my castmates would not maybe agree with, but surprisingly, the one thing that I learned was how to focus my energy to the back of the house, and the slow burn was my favorite lesson that I ever learned, because I am an all over the map, kind of like my Wi-Fi tonight. I am that kind of energy, and to have that big spender. And I remember when Verdon went down the line and read all of our lines for us and did each, and like it was nothing. And I was like, how am I ever going to live up to this creature of talent? And then to have Annie there. So that spark, I don't know. They found a spark, something they saw. I think it was just, for me, it was the stillness, the work ethic. And I would stand in the wings, and I think this was common in Fosse, and I watched Crunchy Granola every night. I wanted to be in it. I knew it. I learned the 18 poses. I was living my best life in the wings while cheering on my castmates. And I think that we always said we were kind of like that kind of, you know, family that, you know, went awry, and we were all different characters, but the love of that show and each other, that's what changed my life. It changed the way I danced, and it changed who I was forever. So thank all of you.
Okay, I have chills from you, but I'm also losing my mind because Crunchy Granola Sweet is my favorite number in the entire show. The song, the vocals, the orchestrations, that dancing, the way it goes from like that lyrical ballet all the way into like the strongest hits you could ever have. I choreographed a version of it for my college like musical theater production. They were like, we're doing a cabaret. I was like, great, I am massively choreographing this song. So like that just, I go ballistic for that, and I want to get into that number. But Parker, you made your Broadway debut with Fosse.
I did. It was a dream.
So what is that like to have to take on Fosse choreography for your first moment on a Broadway stage?
Well, my path was pretty unique because I was in college at NYU taking Chet Walker's class religiously. So a teacher of mine said, go to BDC and take Chet's class. You'll love it. Well, I'm in the room and looking around, and I can tell you what Broadway show every dancer was in. And I was just soaking it all up. Little did I know, everyone was auditioning for Fosse. Everybody was in the room workshopping the material. So I was learning one number after another weekly for a year and a half.
Oh, wow.
And then when the show came in to the Broadhurst, I was selling merchandise for Ragtime on Broadway, and my company took over Fosse. So Here I am, back of house, selling souvenir programs and t-shirts for FOSSE. No joke. And I watch one number, I'm like, oh, I know that number. And then I watch Crunchy, I'm like, wait a second, I know that number too. And Frug and Sing Sing, all of them. And I went, oh my gosh, I've been learning this entire show and the rep for these last couple years. So what did I do? I auditioned for any replacement call that came up, for any position I could get. And without those Broadway credits under my belt, Annie always would say, oh, kid, good to see you again, right? It wasn't, I didn't have those credits under my belt like these fierce people in the room. And I had a newborn child, and my wife said, hey, there's this thing called BTP down in Florida. You should audition for it. You can get to know Annie. And so I went down to Tampa, learned from Ann Ranking in person, learned from Gwen Verdon. Gwen taught me Who's Got the Pain. Unbelievable. Well, while I was in Florida, I learned From the Edge, Hot Honey Rag, and Blackbird. And while I was there, Annie one day pulled me in down the hallway and said, come here. I went into a studio. It was just Ann and Gwen. And they said, listen, we're going to take you through a little audition. I had to do Hot Honey Rag and From the Edge.
Wow.
And as I went up to the piano to go over my my cut, Dave Clemens was playing the piano at the time. I'm standing there, and Gwen says, oh, I just love Patrick. And I was like, is she talking about me? She's like, yeah, I think she's talking
You're
about
Patrick.
Me. I was like, I'm Patrick in this moment. That's fine. And I got back up to sing. And before I could sing, Annie said, listen, we want to make you an offer. Marc Oka just gave his notice on Broadway, and you have a baby. Don't you want to go back home and do a Broadway show? And I said, yes.
Yes, I do.
Yes, I do. And so I was in rehearsals the next week. 6 days later, I was on stage with my idols on stage with this beautiful group. And it was a dream come true. So I, for opening night, my crew in the back of house took a FOSSE souvenir t-shirt and took a Sharpie, connected the F to the O, so it spelled E-S-S-E, my last name.
And, Steve Parker, you and I are now connected for life because we have amended the name to fit our own.
Yeah. It was a dream. And you were talking about Crunchy earlier. I was a swing. I covered 10 out of 12 tracks.
I cannot even imagine being a swing on that show.
And it was always fresh because I was on for somebody else every night.
Well, because what is so interesting when you watch back is that being a swing is always insane to me. And for people out there who don't know, a swing is an understudy for the ensemble. So you oftentimes, like, you'll have a male swing and a female swing. FOSSE had more than that, but you're covering every track. And a lot of times it's the same movement in a different spot. So there are like different traffic patterns, but like it's a lot of the same movement. If you watch FOSSE, no one's doing the same thing. Like there are very, I think that's why the moments of unison are so special, is because they're used in moments of rarity. And a lot of times there's, you know, there's group one over here, there's group center, there's group upstage right, you know. And so swinging that show, I was rewatching the DVD and just going, this is crazy. And also, I mean, props to Lainie because she knows all the, even though she didn't swing, I think that's also maybe even more confusing that you had to make and learn every part and then figure out which one was your own.
Well, I didn't choose which one was my own.
No, I mean your brain had to figure out which one was your own.
You know what's interesting is that a lot of times when I'm teaching, it's so intense because you have 2 weeks to put people in, that I would, a lot of times, I have to get in their face and I could reverse all the numbers. So I would reverse all the numbers facing them, dancing like this, right? And then flip back. So, it was kind of intense. And I also want to mention that we used to have a very clear, Annie put in a first, second, third cover for every single feature.
Wow.
So every time someone was out, it wasn't like then the swing just went on. So Brad Musgrove, the co-dance captain, and I ended up getting cell phones, our first cell phones in Boston when we were out of town, because I get a phone call from the PSM every single time someone's out. Okay, how do we put everybody on? And because it was like first, second, third. Yeah. So it was.
Oh,
it
my
was
God. Crazy. That's amazing. Yeah. All right. Yeah. I want to pause. Rochelle, will you read this donation that came in? It's in the comments. Can you see it?
Let me see. Wait
it
a
says
minute.
I'm yeah. loving these stories.
I'm loving these stories about FOSSE. Yes. I'm loving these stories about FOSSE tonight, especially about Anne Ranking and Gwen Verdon, but all of the stories are wonderful. Thanks for sharing, Seattle Susie Q, $20. Thank you, Susie Q, Seattle.
Yes, thank you. And everyone, please keep donating. Please keep donating at starsinthehouse.com. And if you want one of these lovely people to read your name and your message out loud, forward your receipt to donations at starsinthehouse.com. So I also want to ask, so I think many of us think about the stillness, the isolations, the kind of juxtaposition of movement that happens where it's like really sharp, then really fluid, like angles, shapes, you know, steam heat has like all the, you know, the leans and the, you know, the head bobs and Rich Man's Frug has, you know, you're basically walking on a slant, but there's also so much classical dance in Fosse's world and in Crunchy. How are all of those things all Fosse?
Well, I think one thing that really affected me is, and Doug, please jump in, but the marriage between the choreography and the music is so extreme. His ear, Fosse's ear, when he choreographed with music, that marriage is incredible. And as a dancer, I don't count music, and you never have to count music. You can just actually ride the movement with his musicality in the steps. And when you talk about angles, what was amazing too is he was an amazing storyteller. So as soon as you stepped on that stage, you were never a dancer. You're always an actor. And your ear was, the marriage for me was the music. That to me showed me when I was hitting hard, when I was pulling back. It was just a beautiful marriage. And it shows his talent as a musician also, I felt.
I was going to say, Doug, I feel like as much as Fosse is a dance style, it's also a musical style, you know, and to put numbers from all these different shows and yet it sounds like a unified score is an amazing feat. What's the Fosse sound to you?
You know, it's a great question. I was thinking about this as we were talking tonight. I think it was whatever his taste was, is what was the Fosse sound and what unified all of this very disparate music. When you think about all the, first of all the different eras of his life that were represented in the show, but then all the different types of music. I mean, you know, everything from sing, sing, sing to crunchy granola. Crunchy granola was a Neil Diamond piece from a concert called Hot August Night, which was a very big hit record in the 70s, right? And it was in dance. And so, but I think what made it Fosse was when music resonated for him, it inspired him to choreograph to it. And I didn't know him at all, but you know, I learned these things anecdotally from talking with Ralph and with Gordon. So what all the music had in common was it resonated for him in terms of when he heard it, he said, this inspires me to want to dance to it, to want to choreograph to it. And so it was our job both when we recreated this material, to recreate it as authentically as possible, but then very tastefully, and this was where Gordon really came in, to make sure that we accented things appropriately so that the choreography really felt fresh and it felt like it had an edge to it. And Gordon was the sort of taste maker around that. And there's a lot of stories I could tell about accents and cymbal crashes and Perry Cabari.
Well,
you guys remember Perry? I mean, he played that show every workshop. You know, it was all about the drums, that show. If you took the orchestra away and Perry played, it would still be Fosse.
I was going to bring this up because it's so percussive. It's percussive from the orchestra, but it's also percussive from the stage. Like all the clucks and the snaps and the slapping of the thighs and the heel drops and the hisses and the sizzles and the whispers. Like it's just... it's a very percussive full body dance style, right? Like you're using your body as the instrument in every way. Like I will never forget, you know, the beauty of steam heat is the, you know, it's amazing. I actually want to play a clip. David, can you play a clip of Dancing Man for us?
Yeah. I wanna be a dancing man. While I can, I wanna list all the sins of time. If I never leave her.
That was a terror to count if you were a sub in the orchestra. Somebody always played in the hole somewhere, right?
That's what's crazy. Wild. And but Marianne, like you were saying, you were just feeling it. You were in that pocket.
Yeah, I mean, it was torture. Anyway.
Remember the slow clap add-on?
Oh.
Oh my goodness, when we had to start. Whenever I was in front, when I was in for Scott Wise, right? That really slow clap, that Patrick Brady's going, okay, take your time, and build to we're all in sync. The rhythm, we all had to breathe together on stage. And oh, it was such a good feeling. Oh, clapping.
I was always so afraid of the one leg, the grind, the hip. I was always, I was never in the number. Then once I was in the front for that section. And every night I was sweating bullets. I was like, I'm going to fall. It's the craziest thing. Those silly things that are so hard and connected. And I'm sorry that I popped out because I want to hear everything that everyone is saying. It's so incredible. It's incredible to hear about the music, Doug, and to hear all of these wonderful things. But yeah, Dancing Man in a full wool suit. I think it was the hottest thing that we wore.
I know. Thank you, Santa Laquasto. The tattoos are gorgeous, but I can't imagine how sweaty you all were under Andrew Bridges' Tony winning lights. But like the vodka that must have been sprayed on those costumes, because for those of you who don't know, it's that vodka is gentle on fabric and removes odor. So that's often how they clean things that you can't put in the wash. But I can't imagine what it was, just buckets of it backstage.
It was a crazy quick change. I mean, that was a crazy quick change going into Dancing Man. Mm-hmm. So we were in place with our hats as the curtain was going up.
I still have bad dreams about making it on stage for that number. I mean, the layers of clothes, you know, all the layers, and then I'm stuck in the lot. I mean, I'm sure you all have that same dream. You know, we all do, right? Oh my God, I can't make it to the stage.
Yeah, also, mine's having a long costume on.
Yeah. Also, this whole show, his choreography is so detailed. Mm-hmm. And so you don't ever have a perfect show. You could have a perfect phrase and then the next phrase you make a mistake, or you can have a perfect number and the next number you just blow it. So there's never like you're always striving for that perfection that does not exist in his work. And I always tell kids when I'm teaching FOSSE now, the challenge is, and that detail is to pull out your honesty in that much detail.
Well, so that's what I wanted to ask you about is all of you said that not only does it physically sit well in your body, but that the storytelling resonated with you. Yeah. And it's so interesting, particularly in this show, there's not a narrative from beginning to end, like in one of the individual shows. Mm-hmm. But I'm curious, like, what was the story for you? Like, pick a phrase for me. Like, I don't know, like, Rochelle, I know that you ended up doing I Gotcha. And I think about, like, this move all the time. I'm just, like, like, going, like, you know? And I'm, like, where, like, or, like, that jerky moment during Kiss Me. And, like, I think about that. But I'm curious, all of you, like, pick your moment and, like, what the story was that you were living on stage.
Well, for me, it was always a relationship. I was never out there by myself. I was always like, from this moment on, that Lainie and I did with Andy Blankenbuehler, there's a relationship. We, even in Crunchy Granola, we lived with relationships with each other. And I love one of the, and then never working for the audience ever. I mean, one of my favorite phrases is when Gwen says, you know, let the audience come to you. You don't work for the audience. And so it would put one thing that I loved is that he broke the fourth wall, but then he didn't go after the audience. Like Jerome Robbins, who would never break the fourth wall, you know, but Fosse broke that fourth wall and then, but never went after that audience. That audience had to come to you. So I always loved those moments.
Wow. There's instinct seeing. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Rochelle.
No, I was going to say for me, it was learning, first of all, how to do that. I'm not sure that I ever mastered it, but because Brad used to always say, let the audience come to you, Sass, for God's sakes, you know, back up. But it's interesting because what Lam said and what everyone seems to say, the connective tissue was the cast. Even when the cast was changing, people were changing roles, they were jumping into other understudies, changing parts. The story was between each and every one of us, to the piece, to the music, to the hits, the sing, sing, sing hits. It was, you know, it was Perry on the drums. Like, it was connected. We were connected to the band. We were interconnected. And I think that story was individual for each number for me. I looked at the best. I understudied the classiest women in show business. Valerie Pettiford taught me what it was to understudy a star, how to act, how to be treated. And I won't ever forget those moments. Those are the moments where you look at that person on stage and you nod and you remember that contact, that eye contact. So that connective tissue, it really does matter that you're not doing everything for the audience or for yourself. And I think that that was a great, great way to learn it in Fosse. I carried that to every show I did after that.
Mm-hmm. There's a story behind, there's a reason behind every step. So you could break down and we could tell you what the meaning is behind every step. In the same way, you have to know what body part is actually initiating something. So someone who might want to try to learn it from a video or something might think, oh, they're shaking their shoulders. They don't really realize that that's just a reaction to some hip bumps that are happening down here. So it's understanding the intention of the story, but also understanding the intention of the movement. And then I'm just going to piggyback on what Rochelle was saying a little bit about our relationship with the music. The thing, I have never been so close with the musicians as I have in Fosse. Like, my now husband, Alex Sanchez, who was an original Steam Heat guy, he was really sorry he's in rehearsal also, but we would go and see their gigs. Like, we would hang out. And then I will say, like, for instance, the story might be a more literal story that you think of, but the story can also be kind of more like concert dance in the sense of, so I was first cover for the beautiful Elizabeth Parkinson in trumpet solo. And so it's called Trumpet Solo, and you're the embodiment of the music. All of Sing, Sing, Sing is the embodiment of the orchestra. That's exactly what you're playing. So I always, when I teach trumpet, I say it's called Trumpet Solo, not Dancer Solo. So the amazing Glenn Drews, Perry Caveri, right? You get to be on the band, on the stage with the band. So the whole intention of when I would go on is always to Glenn. I'm always listening to you. There's Perry Caveri.
Here we go, there's Perry Caveri.
Yes. Perry and I have clocked hundreds of hours together. Then that's the other thing, is we always had Perry in the room, which shows you how the music was always a priority. But just listening to Glenn, hearing Glenn, it's jazz. It's like it's changing constantly. So you have to change with them. And I will share my most Gwen.
Yeah, and there you are with Gwen.
And I would say my most favorite compliment I ever got in my whole life, Doug, was when some of the guys in the pit said, we love it when you go on for trumpet because you dance like a jazz musician. And that tells you, like, the idea of, like, that's exactly what we're trying to do, is that marriage between us as dancers and the musicians. Yeah.
So I really do want to know though, like Steam Heat, very famous number. Like, what is the story of like why they're slanted backwards, why their heads are bobbing, what like the rolling is about? What's all in that, Lainie?
I mean, yeah.
No, go ahead.
No, go ahead. No, you go. Go.
No, I just talked. Go ahead.
No, I love it. No, go right ahead. I just love the Zima.
We'll go Lainie, then Marianne.
Or Marc, you go too.
You did it, Marc.
Yeah.
Can you remember?
Well, right. It was Steam Heat, literally the embodiment of the steam radiator in the room. And, you know, that, I mean, I think that goes back to the comment you just made, and I'm going to throw it back to you ladies, Lainie. And there you go. There's Michael Paternostro, Alex, and oh my God.
Jane.
And Jane right here. Thank you, Blank. Jane, I'm so sorry. You know, I love you, Jane. Yeah, the embodiment of the music. But go ahead, ladies. I'm going to throw it back to you to talk about Steam Heat. I didn't actually do the number. Parker, you probably did the number.
I did the number. Sides. Did the number. It gave me lots of anxiety because of that kip up to the knee.
Yeah. In the hat.
Yeah, and the weight. I just. That's my.
Oh my God! Hat. Yes, the bowler.
The hat. I took my hats after the show closed. I took them home. But no, it was the simplicity of the movement and dancing as one, and I think that was key in the show. And my amazing colleagues touched on that earlier. You become one with the music, and you're an extension of the music. So even though there's three of you dancing on stage, it's really one sound, one movement. And I was going to say that about Sing 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 when Lainie was talking about trumpet solo, because there was also a section called the piano solo, but it was a duet. It was two men tap dancing, and Eugene danced it brilliantly. Eugene Fleming danced it brilliantly, and I would dance with him quite often in that section, and I'd go off stage like just waiting for like a, you know, yeah, or a high five or, you know, something. And he didn't say a word. And one night we went off stage and he said, "Listen, feel." And I went, "Great." So the next show we were on together dancing that, the taps became one sound. The taps were one sound, and it was an extension of the music. And that's what the style, you really had to dance between 0 and 4. Nicole Fosse talks about dance between 0 and 10 and how very few people dance between a 0 and 4, right? Mm-hmm. The simplicity of doing less and being connected to the music. And that's what I think Eugene was talking about. What a great lesson.
Absolutely.
Key in the style.
I think posturing too has a lot to do with the character and the class of person too. Because if you think about Steam Heat, right? It's a union rally. Yeah.
Yep.
All blue collar, right? At a factory. So of course we're going to be like slumped over, hanging over, you know, and that's going to be, and
yeah,
it's
that makes
blues, sense. Right? The music. And so that's the character of Steam Heat versus maybe Frug, like the lead Frug girl, upper crust, you know, the sternum is up, you know, you're pulled up, you feel you're smelling, they say pig shit, you know, like, you know, because that's the idea of us being upper crust. So I think a lot of movement that you're seeing and you're asking about has to do with the reflection of the personality of the character. So because we have to physicalize it, right? Because that's the storytelling aspect, is that we can't use our words necessarily, you know, in those dance numbers that we're not singing. And so that's what we're portraying, characters. And just like Lam said so perfectly, is we're actors first. That's what we were.
That's right. Which is why, you know, I also just want to say, like, yes, this was in the category and did win for best musical, because there was so much character in that show. There was, you know, it doesn't have to be narrative from beginning, you know, from curtain up to curtain down. They were mini narratives, you know, every single one of them.
That's, I think that was the fun of it, that you got to exit the stage as one character, change, tease your hair, do a quick change, come back as another character, and completely, I remember watching people go from crunchy changing, you know, or later on in the show into the Frug, and it was like, magic happened. and they came on as a completely different character. And I love the part, I love everything about FOSSE because it helped us to not take ourselves too seriously because the sense of humor. I mean, I used to do comedy numbers when I was a kid. My mother always made me do like the wallflower, the pizza lady. And I thank her now. I'm like, thanks, Ro, for always having, you know, me do something that I wasn't trying to be the prettiest, the best, the you know, in a different way because FOSSE, he liked those characters and that was fun. Mm-hmm. So that those are things that I treasure. That
okay, so I have to ask as the nerd and also because we've all talked about Crunchy, like what's the story in Crunchy? Because I'm listening to those lyrics, but I'm also watching to the like watching the fun that's happening on stage.
Gosh.
Lainie.
I mean, one thing I have to say, I'm sorry, Lainie. It was
No, go Marianne. Go Marianne.
It was the 70s. I mean, that's one thing, like we were talking, I mean, he danced in the 30s all the way up, you know, to the 70s. And and if you look at Blackbird and if you look at the way he directed Blackbird with Liza, it is jamming. It is crazy and it is funky, you know, and that's the thing about FOSSE. So later on, he became a lot more lyrical, but he's funky. He was a funky dude, and I was very lucky to work on FOSSE Verdon, the Netflix, FX series.
FX
and
series, yeah.
We heard a lot of his, like his, he taped a lot of interviews, and he thought of himself as funky. He had a lot of funk in him. So I just want to throw that out too, because I think a lot of people think of him always so smooth and glamorous, but he was funky. He was a funky dude.
If you think about Crunchy.
Funky FOSSE.
Yeah, he was funky, man.
Lainie, you were going to say?
No, I was just going to answer your question just a little bit. You know, if you think about when you walk into a dance studio, what I love about Crunchy, it's like it's about dancers. You walk, the first girl walks down, you walk into the studio, and for me, the studio was always my church. And that's what one thing I love about Crunchy. You have a moment where you look in the mirror and you're just, every notice, your eyes are never off the front when you're doing the beginning, because it's just like when you're in class, when you're carefully going through that beginning. When it starts to build and twitch and build, and we get into this moment where we're just really serious, and then we have that little smile on the next account, it is a shift, an acting shift beat, where it's like, we're just kidding, there's something more, which I relate to so much, being classically trained and then busting out into the jazz section. And that's where we just have a great time and we party our asses off.
So,
I just, I wanted to throw that. And I also just want to quickly throw out there, you know, we talk a lot about the piece and our journeys, but I'm just going to honestly say, this work doing FOSSE, I feel like I can say this for everybody, pushes you to your limits. I don't know anyone that hadn't broken down in tears multiple times because they had just been pushed so hard with this work. But you know, when you do great work, if you're not, I think that's the sacrifice you make. You don't get to stay in a safe zone. You're kind, you had asked us, what was it? How can you do all these different styles? Actually, nobody can do every single style the best. So you are always vulnerable. You're always being pushed outside of your comfort zone. And that was the thrill. Like, I know all of us have done shows where it was like, we can do the show. But yeah, that show, it constantly pushed you. Just like how Sass was saying, every day was an audition. So I just wanted to throw out there that emotional journey when young people are like, oh, yes. No, it wasn't just a piece of cake, guys.
It was hard work. When one of the jokes amongst the male swings was, and I had the fortunate honor of covering Marc. I went on for Marc when he wasn't in the show. And the running joke was, if you can make it through Crunchy in Marc's track, you're going to do okay. Because Marc's crack was so talented.
Beast mode.
Yes, Marc, I love your crack. And from Blackbird into From the Edge into Crunchy to Dancing Man, you were on, and it was about stamina and eating half your dinner. When you were on. You know, you're like Lainie said, it was you. Once you hit the stage, there was no turning back. That's why once we got to Sing, 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 it was something else. It was something it was palpable on stage because everybody was, you know, reaching their third and fourth win and pushing through that number. These were 7.5, 8.5, 10-minute numbers.
Right.
And somehow you'd get to the 18 poses at the end of Crunchy early in the show, admittedly, right?
Yeah.
And you just leave it on the stage. I mean, you can't hold back. You can't.
No.
You can't.
That boom, 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 and then you get to the crescent.
Yes.
Do it again at the end.
Because Doug nailed it. Doug Perry nailed it. I want to be cognizant. Everybody has been so generous with their time, and we are rounding towards the end of this. Everybody, please, please continue to donate. And while you continue to donate, I want to ask Doug, like, this idea of the funk in it, because I think that was really strong. You had a huge horn section, but you used that synthesizer so well. Like, tell me about putting the funk in that.
Crunchy Granola, it was from Dancin', but originally on the Neil Diamond album, and I happened to know that album because my parents were real Neil Diamond fans, and I grew up in the 70s, so we used to listen to it. And it was the opening of the concert. So Hot August Night was a live concert outdoors, and Crunchy Granola Sweet and that piece that preceded it was the opening of the concert. And it was like a piece of concert music that Neil Diamond must have loved. I don't know the story, but that was like the overture to the concert. And then it went into Crunchy Granola Sweet. So on the original Hot August Night album, that intro is an orchestra. It's a string section. They must have had like a full orchestra along with the, you know, his band. And Gordon Harrell said to me, well, we don't have a string section. And we did do some strings on synthesizers and that sort of thing. But he said, how can we do this and just make electronic sounds? Like, what can we do to recreate this in a different way and bring the same feeling across without, you know, showing our, using fake strings and bringing that out front and, you know, looking foolish. So we came up with this idea of using these synthetic sounds to replace the sounds of the orchestra. And we had we had an amazing keyboard programmer. And so we all worked together and came up with this kind of electronic version of this overture, which fit with the rest of the show. There was a lot of electronic material in the show. We used the keyboards and synths, you know, to great effect and mixed with the sound and coming from all different speakers all over the theater. But then when we got into Crunchy Granola, that was, you know, and Ralph Burns had orchestrated it in Dancin', so I was working from his original chart. But because I was 33 years old, and I had to put my little stamp on it. So I remember watching the number, and there's one section that I'm particularly proud of called the popcorn section, right? You guys remember popcorn, where they're bouncing them down like popcorn. And I watched the rhythm.
Oh, I love that section.
I watched the rhythm of it, and there wasn't anything particularly in the music that accented that rhythm. So I rewrote it, and nobody ever commented on it. I just like did my.
You just did it.
When you hear the popcorn, it fits the choreography exactly. Because I wanted it to really like fit like a glove, you know, like a custom thing, instead of just being kind of what was in Hot August Night to be something that was custom.
Well, bravo. My last question for all of you, you'll give your quick little 30-second answer, but all of you have turned out to be storytellers, many of you choreographers. And I find that so fascinating that so many of our great choreographers across the country in regional theaters for off-Broadway, you know, people who are working on Broadway like Sergio Trujillo and Andy Blankenbuehler and Christopher Gattelli all came through this show. So what is it about being in this show that allows you to be the choreographer or the storyteller that you are? And what was it about FOSSE that impacted you all in that way?
Diving deep into the style.
Parker, hit it, man.
The style was so important. And choreographers all have a lineage, right? There's Jack Cole, and then the list goes on. And so we're all taking tips and nuggets from all of the choreographers before us. And FOSSE was undoubtedly one of the greats. So it's taking that style, because we were very fortunate to learn so many different styles within that show, to then use as tools to, you know, continue to create and build upon. And I think understanding the style and the simplicity and the storytelling within the movement and what the intention was behind the movement helped me and probably all of us as storytellers, for sure.
Marc,
go for it. Yeah.
Thank you. I was going to say it's a combination of a couple of things we said, that vulnerability that you were talking about, Lainie and Marianne, and actually Rack, each of us have mentioned that vulnerability, going past the point you really thought you could, and then finding confidence on the other side. That was key. Like the attitude, it could be small, but the attitude was fierce, and the intention that was behind it, that either you could create for yourself or you could understand from the greats that were all around us, feeding us, to motivate it. That's where I think that's what really affected me as a dancer, as a performer. And that's what the audience needs. Like, they want you to be your utmost confidence and to go there where you think you can't go. And this work like forces it. You're right, Lainie. And then you find yourself on the other side through it. And that's where that magic for me as a performer that I can share with the audience. So to me, that's what it was.
Hmm. Rochelle, what about you?
Well, I think I can't speak for anyone else, but sometimes when you work with people, there were a lot of collaborations happening in FOSSE, and you kind of, I went off and worked with Chet on the Jack Cole project. I worked with Annie on something else. And again, it's like you take from everyone that's around you, and then you find your voice. It's like anything. It's either you have something to say, and by taking a little bit from all that you've learned, and or, you know, you want to keep performing. Some people went on and became, you know, obviously they're in front of me, great choreographers. I went deeper into writing stories and writing characters and telling stories in a different way. So I think that FOSSE really affected all of us to say, let's take what we have and, you know, go with it. And it made us all, I think, if I can speak, a little fearless in ways of trusting ourselves, because I didn't trust myself nearly as much as I did do now, but it started 20 years ago, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Marianne?
Oh my goodness, that was so beautifully said. Everybody, I mean, that's, I agree with everybody. And I have to say, every one of us in that show had such love to dance. I mean, you can feel how much he loved to dance. Mm. And we will be dancers forever. And I think that that's because of what Lainie and everybody has given us through FOSSE. Like, you know, Lainie and Anne Reinking and Gwen Verdon. And, you know, they were all my FOSSEs, because I never got to, I was like you, Marc. I was dying to work with them, and he passed away. But one thing that I feel like we love to dance, and I feel like we learned that to storytell with our bodies, and that dance is internal, not external, is everything to me.
But, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Lainie, we'll end with you.
Yeah.
I'll say that FOSSE inspired me to create new work and not being afraid to fail. Look at Sweet Charity was a huge bomb. He almost quit his career. And look at us, we're just still watching it today. Not being afraid to push the envelope. You know, I wrote my own musical, Corner and Bitter and Sweet. And
yes, she did.
You know what I mean? And so, like, and so that ability to just go for it. But also this other interesting lesson, which was at some point you have to stop. Take a breath, you idolize FOSSE, but then you need to find your own voice. So you take a step back and you realize, don't keep saying to yourself, I'm never gonna be FOSSE. No, none of us are gonna be anybody else. So you take, we also take a step back from that as well. So I'm gonna say it's the twofold. It's the inspiration, but also sometimes letting go and saying, now it's your turn. It's our turn. This is the generation right here. You're looking at it, right? This is the generation. We're supposed to be doing this now. It's our turn to do that. So it's our turn to create new work now.
Amen. Amen. Well, I am going to challenge the audience to donate as much as possible in the next 1 minute. We're going to play 1 minute from FOSSE. You're going to donate as much as possible. And in the meantime, I want to thank Lainie Sakakura, Doug Besterman, Parker Esse, Marianne Lamb, Marc Calamia, and Rochelle Rack for being here tonight. Please follow all of them and all of their work because they are all still creating. So if you're a FOSSE fan, you got to follow these people. All right, ladies and gentlemen, sing, sing, sing. Thank you all so much for being here tonight. Remember to donate at starsinthehouse.com. And we just want to thank you for celebrating FOSSE with us. That was a clip from the Tony Awards performance of the original cast of FOSSE back in 1999. Thank you so much to everyone who tuned in and to everyone who was here. And don't forget, tune into tomorrow's Stars in the House, tomorrow night, 8 p.m. Eastern. It's going to be a dogfight reunion. And I hope that you will continue to support us as we continue to make it through this time. You can find more from me at ruthiefierberg.com. Hopefully this won't be the last time I see all of you at Stars in the House. Until next time.